Surrender the Radio with your host, Gen T.
Yeah, fucking Gen is a warlord.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to Ramble Bro Radio. I am your host, Gen T. Twitter and Instagram at Gen T. 523. What's good, motherfuckers? You already know what time it is. Today's the day. Tony Hawk. The fucking Tony Hawk Pro Skater game came out today. And you know what that means? I got to do this podcast hella fast so I can get to playing, you understand? But before I get to playing, I got to talk to you guys about UFC. And if you don't like UFC, then fast forward 10 minutes ahead, because we're talking fights. Do I do it this suffering? I need a minute to myself, so all you break away. You will never get to me. I can't be done on to myself, so all you break away. But the blood, I've got my UFC picks for you. First of all, there's a few unknowns for me on here, so I will announce those as I approach them. Like this one, Cole Smith versus Hunter Azure. This is two unknowns. Cole Smith is Canadian, so I like my Canadian family. Oot na boot, loonies and toonies. So I'm going to go with Cole Smith, 7-1, 2 KOs, 3 subs, 2 decisions. Team Quest Thailand. I didn't even know they had Team Quest Thailand, but I'll take it. versus Hunter, 8-1, 3 KOs, 1 sub, 4 decisions. We riding with Cole Smith. Next, Marcus Rogério de Lima versus Alexander Romanov. Marcus, 12 KOs, 3 subs, 2 decisions, 17-6. Brazil. Alexander, 11-0, 5 KOs, 6 subs. Well, I'm going to go with Marcus because I know this dilemma. I mean, not personally, but I have picked him to win before. So we're taking Marcus. Next, Montana De La Rosa versus Vivian Arroyo. 11-5, Montana De La Rosa, 8 subs, 3 decisions. Vivian, 8-2, 3 KOs, 4 subs, 1 decisions. These two are just about identical, except clearly Vivian is the better grappler. But as far as strikes, we're going to take Montana De La Rosa. Next, Bartosz Fabrinski versus Andre Muniz, Brazil. Bartosz is 15-3, 8 KOs, 7 decisions. Ugh. Andre is 19-4, 4 KOs, 12 subs, 3 decisions. I'm going to go with Andre, of course. He will probably cement Bartosz. Next, Thiago Moises, 13-4, 3 KOs, 5 subs, 4 decisions versus Jalen Shits Bernardino Turner, 9-5, 8 KOs, 1 sub. Well, you riding with Shits Bernardino. The Tarantula has to get it done, but Thiago Moises is no slouch. ATT certified, but Jalen Turner trains at none other than Shits Bernardino, aka Adrenaline Combat. I believe he will get this done. Next, Kevin Natividad versus Brian Kelleher. Kevin is 9-1, 5 KOs, 1 sub, 3 decisions. Brian is 21-11, 8 KOs, 9 subs, 4 decisions. I'm going to go with Brian Kelleher. Next, Michael Pieria versus Zalim Imdiv. Michael, 23-11, 10 KOs, 6 subs, 6 decisions. Zalim Imdiv is 8-2, 8 KOs, 0 subs, 0 decisions. So he's finishing fights. I'm going to go with Mother Russia. OSP, Ovin St. Preux versus Alonzo Menfield. OSP, 24-14, 11 KOs, 8 subs, 5 decisions. Alonzo, 9-1, 8 KOs, 1 sub. Trains at Saxons, my potential gym. I'm going with Alonzo. And finally, Alistair Overeem versus Augusto Sakai. 46-18, 24 KOs, 17 subs, and 5 decisions. Augusto has 11 KOs, 0 subs, and 4 decisions. So, this is a close one. I've been watching a lot of Augusto fights, and all of the people he was fighting were standing in front of him. So, my thought is that Overeem is going to be on his bike, and he will be moving around on the outside, which will be helpful to his advantage, but because he is also creating the distance, being far on the outside, it might open him up to being countered. So we shall see, but I'm going to ride with Overeem. My final UFC pick rundown is following Cole Smith, Marcos de Lima, Montana De La Rosa, Andre Muniz, Jalen Turner, Brian Kelleher, Zalim Imdiv, Alonzo Menfield, and Alistair Overeem. Those are your UFC picks. Bet with me, bet against me. Who fucking cares? Let's have some fun and watch the fights. It's time for Customers of the Week. This one was the strangest one yet I've experienced. I've never had somebody complain about being too nice. This actually didn't happen to me, but then I somehow got sucked into the black hole sun. I was on the phone helping somebody, and our conversation had ended with another customer, and just to help out, and of course you guys know I like to go outside and get shopping carts, helps me think, helps me get some fresh air, helps me get a break for some of the weirdos inside. And at this time, I was getting ready to go grab some shopping trolleys, for those of you who are from England. Some trolleys, collector trolleys. As I'm walking by, I hear this guy talking to my coworker, and my coworker was like, "Oh, did you have a membership with the store? What's your membership ID?" And he goes, "What? What?" And she goes, "What's your membership ID so I can give you points, and which would lead to a discount once all your points are accumulated?" You know, you ask me that every time, and I have to tell you, I'm not a member. I'm like, whoa, 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 whoa. Slow down, Smokey. Slow down. She's like, "Sir, I'm just asking you if you're a member. You don't have to be a member. It's my job to ask you that," which, if you worked at my work, every register has that note on the top. Make sure you asked if the customer's a member. She's like, "I'm just doing my job." And he's like, "Well, don't ask me about the membership. I ain't a member, okay? You ask me every time." He's like, "Don't you get it? I don't want to be a part of your membership." She goes, "Okay." And I was just like, "Oh, righty then." And so I was just kind of hanging around because I didn't know what next this crazy-ass dude was going to do to the other cashier who was doing their job. So I was walking slowly by the register, and my other homie was talking to me about basketball, and he always says the most outrageous things, kind of like at Johnny Football. My homie said something crazy about basketball, and I was just like, "That's a good one, bruh, but better luck next time." Good thing you're not in charge of the league, you know what I mean? And then we were laughing out loud, and then as I'm walking outside, the customer comes up to me and goes, "How come you get to be so happy?" And I was like, because I can. I was just like, wow, dude, maybe because in the back of my mind, it's like, maybe because I'm not an absolute prick like you. And then I saw what car he got into, and then I realized, oh, well, you kind of get an excuse to be a prick. You're driving a Prius. So am I. That shit sucks. Oh, damn it. But I was just like, every time you come into the store, you have an attitude. Everybody's just doing their job. It's not personal. Like, the only one that's making it personal is you. So I don't know what your fuck problem is. And he's just like, yeah, how come you get to be so happy? What do I gotta be that happy? What do I gotta do to be that happy? I was just like, I don't know, just enjoy it. That's what I do. I just thought to myself, it's like, wow, okay. So he looked to be about mid to late 50s, early 60s. So I'm assuming he's retired. I could be wrong, but I'm just like, man, people are out here fucking dying. People are starving. People are out here getting sex trafficked. Like, some weird ass shit is going on. Black people are getting shot by the police. I mean, that's nothing new. I mean, this is how the world is working. People are getting COVID and dying. Not as many as the CDC said, but people are still dying. You have to say to yourself at some point, enough's enough. You're in charge. Like, if you want to be happy, then be happy. Like, my solution is just to be happy despite the shitty circumstances. I would love to travel and see my friends. I miss my friends. I miss going out to grabbing a bite to eat with my friends and hanging out and having a good time. I miss my other family members that don't live in this town. I want to see my family that I haven't seen in months. I would love to go to the gym, both of my gyms, but that's not going to happen, Uncle Gavin. Thanks a lot. I miss my gym friends. I miss all the little kitties that would train at the gym. And dating sucks right now. Like, right before COVID hit, I had bought a bunch of cool dating, nice dating clothes, and I was gonna make a big run at the club. I was just gonna go for it. I was just like, I'm gonna go to the club every night until I find somebody. And then, bam! COVID. DJ COVID. Fuck, man. It's just like, all this shit has happened. Stressed out at work. I mean, when the back of my mind, I'm like, there's a way to eliminate this stress. Pretty simple. I want to work for me. That way I don't have to worry about somebody else's stress getting thrown on my plate. I don't have to worry about somebody else's attitude. It's just me. So it's just like, I couldn't understand that this guy couldn't realize just how lucky we were standing there having that moment. I'm just like, we could be fucking drugged up, dead in a ditch somewhere in the street, or I could be fucking sex trafficked. Like, I'm watching some show called McMafia. It's terrible, but I'm trying to hang in there. And one of the girls gets abducted. She did something super stupid for some kind of modeling thing and ended up in Egypt. And then these two dudes grabbed her. And her other friend tried to make a run for it, and they shot her in the legs and left her there in the desert to die. And now she's being sex trafficked to other rich businessmen, and she's trying to figure out a way how to get out of there. The whole show's crazy, but that's not that far from the truth. I'm assuming somebody is using the newspaper and just reading what's going on in the newspaper, and that shit happens all the fucking time. There's sex trafficking, pedophilia, human trafficking, the whole nine. This shit sucks, man. But I'm not in that situation, and I'm grateful for that. Like I said, my biggest complaints are I live in a weirdo town, and I don't have a pool at my house, and I would like to make more money. I would also like to be able to retire and go to the gym. So, I mean, my list is so short compared to somebody that was behind my house the other day. I'm not joking. I may or may not have talked about this on here. Behind my house, slept not on the sidewalk behind my house, but actually in the street, huffing paint, was laying in the bike lane, huffing paint in the street. People are whizzing by his head at 50 plus miles an hour, and he's laying down in the street huffing paint. And I was just like, what the fuck? Yo, what? What? How did this happen? How did he end up there? And I'm at where I'm at. It just doesn't make sense to me. And then I start to realize not everybody has the same opportunities. You're supposed to do with what you have. Maybe this young man got caught up in drugs. Maybe he came to California and he lived somewhere else and got caught up in drugs, or has a mental illness. Can't be brought to a hospital because California law, you can't like put somebody in the hospital just because you want them to be there. They have to like really prove that they need to be there. And right now the fucking hospitals are overworked. So a lot of crazy people are out on the street. And here's this guy, huffing paint, laying down in a 50-mile-an-hour, 55-mile-an-hour zone, just like nothing's going on. And I was just like, wow, holy shit. Immediately, once that grumpy-ass customer said, how come you get to be so happy? I think about that. I think about how that would be my worst fear, that I would lose everything, lose my job, lose my family, and I would just be homeless. Like, that freaks me out. I don't know, sir. Maybe it's because I'm grateful for what I do have. And I'm not really trying to focus too much on the things I don't have. So have a nice day. I was just like, Jesus Christ, man. You don't have to be a prick to people at the store. Like, I get you're having a bad day or whatever, but my girl at the cashier, like, it literally says on the top of her computer, ask every customer if they are a member. Like, that she's just doing her job. Like, she could give two fucks about you. So let's keep it 100. You don't need to treat her like shit. She's trying to be nice to you because it's her job. So I was just like, man, you gotta really stop and think about that. And speaking of weird customers, this is actually from Walmart. A guy was kicked out of Walmart in Anchorage, Alaska. And the funny bit about this particular customer was right when the altercation starts, he starts screaming, I'm a man of God. I'm a man of God. You can't kick me out of the store. It's like, wait a minute. You're in a private store. It's not a government sanctioned store. They get to do whatever they want. And if they're telling you to leave, then you need to leave. And oh yeah, it just so happens that you don't have a mask or you don't want to wear a mask. So you can't come in. Those are the rules that they set in place. Which those rules came from the city of Anchorage in order to keep people from spreading COVID, however little bit people have or a lot that people have. They're just following the rules from the city. They don't want to get fined. This guy's like, I'm a man of God. I'm a man of God. You can't kick me out of the store. I'm like, yes, we can. It's a private store. And he's like, you motherfucker. Just starts going off. And I'm just like, wow. Just his reaction, I'm going to play it for you in a little bit, but his reaction was just so out of control. You have currently just lost the plot. The people that work at the store have nothing to do with the rules. They're just told to abide by those rules. In order to work there, they are instructed, anybody who comes in here with a mask, they need to be asked to leave. That is their job. Working for the job that I work at, we don't ask people to leave. If you're not wearing a mask, you're not wearing a mask, which is fucking weird to me. But I try to respect people's privacy. I'm not going to stay around and help you if that's what you think is going to happen without a mask. So that's my personal policy. If you ain't wearing a motherfucking mask and I don't know you, stay the fuck back. So I was just like blown away watching this tape. All right, here is this douchebag who goes completely off on the workers at the store here. Here we go.
And get out of a godly man's face. No, I will. By your very blind ignorance, you don't have the ability to even come up with your own ideas. I believe it when I absent. You have not established authority to tell me to leave. You go get management. You want your car? You find management that I can no longer.
Yeah.
You have more management here. You want to speak to the car?
Are you exercising your right as a private company? Take away my rights.
Jesus Christ.
You can say you can refuse service. Are you refusing my service?
Yes.
Why don't you say we refuse your service? No. I choose to yell, and you cannot stop me!
Okay, that's cool. Bye.
Bye.
Please return to the service of Satan in your ignorant belief that you are right.
That's cool. Bye.
Please, in the future, respect my rights. No one else's. You will never in my 6 foot space.
Have a good day.
And I can tell you. I will tell you you are wrong.
Oh, I know.
Stop me?
I know.
Do you want to stop?
Don't touch her. Don't touch her.
Bring your police. Bring your police. You will not.
Have a good day.
I will.
I got you on video, so why don't you just go ahead and leave?
I have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Have a good day.
My happiness is best started by standing in your face and say you are a fool and wrong. You have no authority over me.
Quit speaking all over people.
Quit
spitting all over people.
Do you need my ID?
No, I don't. I need
your ID. You're trying to... I'm wrong?
No, if you touch me, I have proof.
No, you threatened to hit me. I all have proof. Not
because,
me, them.
Because you're trying to fight everybody in the goddamn store.
Now, fight involves contact, doesn't it?
Yeah, and you're about in contact,
you got...
You're about in my contact.
And when you got my face and threatened to hit me, you were this close.
Because you stepped up in my face.
Thank you. Do we want to take this phone?
You threatened me!
Ain't nobody threatening you! Get out of the store!
You said you would! Come, you little blind! You aren't even human! You're all the animal!
Thank you.
Shut the door on him.
What a fucking douchebag, man. Just... I'm a man of God, and these my constitutional rights. Why can't you say you refuse your service? It's pretty simple. They're refusing your fucking service by asking you to leave because you don't want to put a mask on. There is your service refused. Get the fuck out. But this is the dumb shit I'd be having to deal with at my work. But now they flipped the script. This last lockdown, they say in the sign, masks are enforced, but we're not enforcing it on our sign, which is the craziest thing. But don't expect me to help somebody who's not wearing a mask, because that's just not going to happen. This gentleman was in every Walmart worker's face yelling within inches, a matter of inches. And I just want to commend these, because there was like four or five of them trying to get this guy out. None of them touched him, but he certainly touched a couple of the female employees. The girl had her arms crossed, and he was rubbing against her arms, flipping her off. So it's like, all right, dude, like, I don't think I would have had the courage to be silent. I probably would have decked this guy. I'm sorry, but there's only so much nice you can get. And if you're going to get in my face and yell, I'm probably going to punch you. Oh, my God. What an idiot, man. Just completely going off. And whether you agree with the mask or not, just fucking wear it. It's real simple. How is it in Japan? They can all wear masks, whether they believe in it or not, for the greater fucking good. If you don't feel well, you put a damn mask on. They don't act like it's an infringement of their civil liberties. So why do people do that here? This is crazy. I want to play you this clip from the Greg Fitzsimmons show, and he had a comedian on. Black comedian, and he talked about how a lot of white people think that wearing a mask is an infringement of their civil liberties. Meanwhile, black Americans in America have to worry about getting pulled over or shot That's just like the simplest thing, putting on a mask versus, oh, I don't know, getting shot 7 times in the back by cops. But I really thought he had a good point here. So let me see if I can find it for you.
Since it started. And that shows you what we could, on a grander scale, what we could have done here in America. We could have done this. We could have contained this.
Yeah, exactly.
Americans are so entitled, particularly white Americans, are so entitled that to tell them what to do seems like, to them, a violation of their freedom.
Yes.
That's why you see white people in fights in the supermarket, like, don't tell me to wear a mask.
Yeah.
And you see them on planes getting in fist fights, like somebody told them to wear a mask. Because right. They're so entitled that to tell them that they have to follow the rules is an invasion of their privacy. Meanwhile, black people daily have to pull their cars over, get out the car, lay face down on the pavement just because the car might have been too nice. Or yeah. You might have been driving a neighborhood that was suspicious. Or we just got a call of a burglar in the area that was 5 feet tall, and you being 6'5", you fit the description.
Right.
We live with this every
day. We live with this every day. So when I see people wigging out about a mask, I'm just like, you need to bring it. You need to bring it in and really think about it. If you think it's such an infringement on your rights, then why are you shopping at this store? If you don't want to wear a mask and the store you shop at has a mask policy, don't shop there. Shop somewhere else. Stay home. Order online. Or do curbside pickup and not roll your window down like Mary. the whole thing is pretty simple, but right away, people want to go from 0 to 60. It's just like the whole thing could be avoided if you just stop and think for a fucking second. Or you can be a decent fucking human being like me. Like, I don't really believe masks work, but am I wearing one? Yes, because I want to make sure that my fellow human next to me who is uncomfortable is comfortable. I'll wear a mask just so a complete stranger could be happy because I'm a good person. That's what I do. And I think that if you don't already do so, you should consider that. We're all on this team human thing. And in order to get us out of lockdown or find some sort of common ground, just wear the goddamn mask. This ain't hard. All right. Enough of my political rant. I'm so tired of these things, man. It's just crazy. People have just, I miss regular humans. But then when I think about and see people having these reactions, maybe people were always this way. They were just very good at hiding it. I miss nice people. I don't like weirdos, but it seems like this year has really been the year of the weirdo. Oh, before I jump on to something else, I just wanted to wrap up that customer of the week. How do I get to be so happy? If I didn't already say so, I think it's important for me to tell you guys that, or gals, don't. Yeah. I'm a lady and I listen to this show. You said guys. Don't be weird. This ain't that kind of show. When I say you guys, that means every fucking buddy. That means gay, straight, bi, trans, non, question, ace, I, T, Q, the whole alphabet. Happiness is a choice. And be grateful for the things that you have. It's time for some current events. This week, I've had a fucking enough with Adele and the Bantu Nuts. I mean, everybody is going fucking crazy. This past weekend was Carnival in London. Adele lives in California, but she was trying to have a little party and celebrate that Carnival was going to be at home this year. And a lot of her London family and friends, because she's from Tottenham, we're celebrating Carnival. So she got all dressed up in her backyard and had herself a little soiree. Fine. Who fucking cares, right? Well, apparently somebody took a picture, or she posted the picture of her look, and she had Jamaican flag bikini on. and some Bantu knots. So if you don't know what Bantu knots are, I guess I should use my Jamaican accent. Adele had her Jamaican bikini on and the Bantu knots on. And Bantu knots are the knots that look like Princess Leia, but all over the head. And who fucking cares? I just don't give a shit. I'm telling you, as a half Jamaican, I was like, okay, I know about Carnival. So I was just like, yep, this weekend's Carnival. Who fucking cares? Kept scrolling. Literally from Sunday to probably Wednesday, it was like everywhere. Every time I open my fucking phone, there was Adele, news about Adele, cultural appropriation. She's stealing Jamaican culture. Who fucking cares, man? Do you know what Jamaican culture is? Whew, man, it's a lot of poor people. And guess what? Adele grew up in a poor black neighborhood. What do you expect her to culturally relate to? That is her home. That's what she knows. So I was just like, if you guys actually did some research, you would know that this is something that she relates to. And I don't like when social media gets all upset about how it's cultural appropriation when it's a white person. Like, Heller, let people do what they want. She was not dressed up in blackface, so who fucking cares? I was just shocked. I was like, homegirl's got a body yaddy now. Let her wear a goddamn bikini and let her have some fun. I don't care if it was an Asian person. I don't care if it was like Lucy Liu who did the same thing. I don't care if it was like fucking, who's the guy right now? Ryan Reynolds. Who cares, man? It's just let people have fun. It's Carnival. You're supposed to get in the skimpiest outfit that you feel comfortable with and dance. That's Carnival. You can YouTube that shit. They get crazy. So the fact that everybody's upset, oh, it's cultural appropriation, blah, 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 whoopty fucking whoop. Chug off, you fucking prick. It's just terrible. Nobody can have no fun anymore. Everybody is after everybody. Everything is like, ooh, I'm gonna tattletale on you. I saw you. And it's just like, oh, come on. Leave people alone. Just go live your life. You're over here complaining to TMZ that Adele's wearing a Jamaican bikini and has some braids. Like, you gotta really stop and self-evaluate your life right now. Oh, let's see what else. Guess what? Guess what, guys? Do you remember when it was turned September? Thank God, we fucking made it. It's September. I mean, the next 3 days are going to be the hottest days ever in California, but we made it to September. It's still fucking hot. Dancing in September. Give me a fucking pool. Yeah, I still can't find a fucking pool to save my life, so I think I'm just gonna turn the hose on and lay in the grass. To be contouvered, check social media for me. Just laying in the grass with the hose. Oh, damn it. Gavin Newsom says California on lockdown until they can find a cure for death. Holy shit. Holy shit. This week, a DJ died. And for those of you who don't listen to DJ music, but I know you will know this song because it's everywhere. It was around when we were kids, and they put it in kids' movies now. I like to move it, move it. I like to move it, move it. I like to move it. DJ Eric Murillo died, and he went under the stage name Real to Real, and that was his hit song. I like to move it, move it. He passed away this week under some unknown circumstances. They are still trying to figure out what the hell is going on. But coincidentally, the reason why I didn't post it initially, I was like, oh no, I like to move it, move it. That was my guy. I was like, oh no. And then just, I found out. Then I found out. I found out my man was under arrest and was due to go to trial the day he died. Or he was due to appear in court the day he died for sexual assault and battery of a female DJ. She stayed at his house and she passed out, and then she remembers waking up. He was standing next to her exposed, and they did a rape kit and they found Simon in this lady. So this guy's a piece of shit. I like the piece of shit. You motherfucker, scumbag, move it. Man, that broke my heart instantly. I was like, oh man, my man died. Oh, what? You a fucking douchebag? You raped somebody? Oh, hell nah. Get the fuck out of here. I didn't post nothing about this guy. I was getting ready to post something, and everyone's like, oh, this beloved DJ, whoop-de-fucking-whoop. And one DJ, one guy, one DJ that I like, Jax Jones, was like, before we go off mourning this guy, I know this is an unpopular opinion, but this dude sexually assaulted somebody, and the day he died, he was supposed to appear in court. So I'm not exactly going to be celebrating this dude just yet. And I would have to agree with that sentiment, so I didn't post anything. I was just like, man, move it, guy is dead, but sounds like he was a scumbag. So, man, that fucking sucks because this lady got raped, and here comes the day in court, and this guy mysteriously dies. They say there's no signs of foul play, but I'm going to be watching this Eric Murillo story very closely because I want to know, did this rata suicide himself because he knew he was guilty? Did somebody kill him? I want to know what the hell's going on. So, to be contuvered. This week on Twitter, the most ridiculous things are trending always on Twitter, but specifically what was trending was that Jhené Aiko is better than Sade. The fuck, bitch? Hold up. Wait a minute. It's a 22. Pew, pew, pew. No, ma'am. No, sir. I will not stand for this. I immediately had to go to Twitter and pop up into the thread and just to educate these youngsters and explain that somebody who sings "Get a bus off for me, cause you gotta eat the booty like groceries." Somebody who sings about eating the booty like it's groceries, there's nothing wrong with eating the booty like it's groceries, but hold up. You're gonna compare that to "Your love is king, drown you in my heart." No! No! Abso-fucking-lutely not. Are we going to compare "You love this pussy, you love this pussy, you love this pussy" to "Seems like you're my paradise"? No! No! Fuck out of here! You've got to be bloody joking. Yeah, I really think the internet has lost their mind. Anybody under the age of 25, listen up now. I'm telling you with peace and love. Jhené has a place. I like that she doesn't hold back. Like, she likes to sing about sitting on a penis like a chair. She pulls it out like a chair. Yeah, cool. I'll play that in a minute. But my girl Sade is classy. You understand? This is just love music with class. And Jhené, you know, there's always room for trash. Trash has a place. I like that. But it is not quality. Anybody can sing about love and pussy, but can they sing about your love being king? Can they sing about "This is no ordinary love, no ordinary love"? So you want to hear "Eat the booty like groceries"? I'm gonna play you this shit. This is fucking terrible. Oh man, hold on. So we're gonna do a little testy test. We're gonna do Jhené Aiko versus Sade, and you tell me, You can tell me in my mentions and my DM. Actually, you don't need to tell me. I know if you listen to my show, you already know who's better. It's Sade. And if you think Jhené Aiko is better than Sade, then you probably shouldn't listen to my show anymore. Stupid, worthless, retarded, big nose son of a bitch. You forgot. Ugly, lazy. Shut up, bitch. Go fix me turkey pot pie. You think this is better than Sade? Fuck out of here. Oh, shit. There it is. You gotta eat the booty like groceries. Hell nah. You think that's better than Sade? You are crazy. This smashes eating the booty like groceries. Look at this. This is so classy. Come on. Come on, y'all. You can't think that Jhené Aiko is better than this. Listen to how beautiful this sounds. Somewhere to stop. No need to bounce. Things are smooth up or better. Come on. The defense rests. Oh, wait. Let me find this other song that everybody likes. This fucking Jhené Aiko. Oh, my God. Oh, here we go. Jhené Aiko, Pussy Fairy. You what? Here's the Pussy Fairy. I know you love fucking me. Oh. God damn it. Holy shit. Whoa, okay. Oh. All right, let's turn the lights off. Pussy Fairy. Oh. All right. You got me. Pussy Fairy. Oh, Jesus Christ. Oh, I can't. This is not... Okay, look. It's good. It's like... background. But like... It's not Sade. Sade is the shit. Damn. Look out, Pussy Fairy. Here comes By Your Side by Sade. Pussy Fairy. I mean, really? It's just not... it's not original, fam. This is original. You think I'd leave your side, baby? Oh, my God. This is amazing. You know me better than that. Come on. There's just... It's no contest. You must choose Sade. There's just no contest. Wait, here's the... I have to find the last Jhené Aiko doodad. Where is it? Now, don't get me wrong. I listen to Jhené Aiko. I like it, but I also like Sade, and I know better. And I know classy, loved up music when I hear it. Jhené Aiko, it's like, are we driving around? Or, oh yeah, let's make out, whatever. Pussy Fairy, yeah, okay, all right. where is it? Oh, here, Maniac. This is the first Jhené Aiko song I heard. I was like, who the fuck is this bitch and why is it playing on the radio?
I'm on a date like a maniac. head like a brainiac.
Okay.
Got a rich sound like a Zodiac.
I'm a little she wants a dick like a maniac.
Good head got a little bite too.
Oh! Okay, here we go. His dick is too long. Get out of here. If you think this is better than Sade, turn my show off now. Get the fuck out. Oh my god. You just made love to a maniac. Oh, here comes the mumble rap. That's the quick way to get me to hit the ejector seat. Mumble rap. Okay. Okay. You just fucked around with a maniac. Oh, wait, where is it? Oh, it's coming up. This is the Pussy Fairy part 2. All right, here we go. I mean, I like pussy as well. You read my mind. Sometimes I sing that out loud when I'm walking around town. Jesus Christ. But I just feel like chicks that talk like that aren't very good in bed. I have to be honest. I feel like if they're that sexually front like that, that they must be terrible in bed. This is the only way. They're constantly talking about sex. You must be horrible in bed. But I can't leave you with the Pussy Fairy. I have to end it with Sade because she's the champion and she should end the round here with this. Come on. You ain't hearing about this chick pulling out somebody's dick and sitting on it. She doesn't say, "Do you love this pussy?" Or as I like to say, "Pussy." This is magic, y'all. Come on. Beam, beam, blow. Come on, everybody can get down with this. This is fire, fam. Everybody's getting down to this. Not everybody gets busy to the Jhené Aiko. I don't get it. Listen to this guitar. You know it's serious. Like, you must have, like, got her, like, tied up or something. Or you got her, like, against the wall. Or it's a man. And you got, like, you're getting ready to pull his thing out. But you don't need to say that. It just happens. Come on. Now this is some real shit. Now if you start making sweet love, I don't blame you. This is some good music. Alright. Yeah, good lord, Jhené Aiko versus Sade. There's no contest. No contest whatsoever. Time to leave you with something interesting this week. My dad decided to commit suicide via muffins. For the last month, he didn't tell anybody that he was eating Costco-sized containers of nuts and seeds every day and gave himself acid reflux and couldn't eat anything other than bran muffins and milk. After a month of this, his nails started to fall off and he couldn't understand why. So I had to have a little chat with him. And upon this chat, I discovered, unfortunately, my parents are my children. So I talked to my dad. I said, I heard your nails are falling off, my guy. What's going on?
Jenny, my stomach, it does not feel good. Jenny, you must help me. Please buy me more muffins.
And I said, well, this is the problem. I've been buying you muffins, Dad. And then I ran into Mom and she was buying you muffins too. So I feel like you've been double dipping on the muffins here. True or false?
Well, Jenny, muffins are the only thing I can eat. My dum-dum hurts.
It's like, well, what's going on? I just can't eat anything other than muffins. I was like, oh, is this a words from your doctor? Like, who is this, Dr. Phil? Dr. Oz tell you to eat muffins only? What's going on? He's like, I'm on a special diet. And I was like, well, what diet is this? Because I know all the diets. Is it the 360 diet? Is it Dr. Atkins? Is it the Mediterranean diet? No, it's the bran muffin diet. Okay. And he's like, Jenny, my tummy is upset. I have to eat something, and the only thing that works is muffins. I said, okay, well, why don't you eat something that is beneficial? Because guess what? If your nails are falling off, that means you are deficient in nutrients, particularly protein. I'm not a doctor, but this is generally the reason.
Oh, Jenny, what can I eat then? It must be soft, soft as a muffin.
And I said, well, I'm glad you asked. Why don't you eat some eggs?
Eggs? Oh, no, Jenny, they are gross.
I'm like, okay, how about some fish?
No, Jenny, no, I can't eat fish.
Okay, how about some steamed vegetables?
No, 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 that doesn't taste good.
I was like, oh, my God, are you a fucking child? I said, look, man, I said, I talked to my boss, I talked to mom, we all had a little discussion, and it looks like you're fucking killing yourself. If your nails are falling off because you're only eating muffins and milk, that means you're not getting enough nutrients. You need to bump up your protein, get some good fats in you.
Good fats? I am already fat, Jenny. I don't want any more fat. Please, you must tell me what else I can eat, but I will only eat muffins.
I was like, Dad, why don't you have an avocado?
Yuck, that is disgusting.
Okay, dude, how about some coconut?
Ooh, yuck.
I was like, how are you from Jamaica and you don't even like coconuts? What is this?
Oh, it's disgusting stuff.
Bran muffins are good for me. I'm like, they are until your fucking nails fall off. And then who knows what else is going to start falling off, man? You got to eat something nutritious. So this week, finally, I guess I did a little scared straight. Whatever I said to my dad, he is finally starting to eat eggs. And before, he would only eat the egg white. He would not eat the yolk. And I said, well, okay, you can eat the yolk, but just, or I said, you can eat the white, but just know that when you throw away the yolk, when mom throws away the yolk, all of the nutrients, all of the important parts of the egg are in the yolk. So you're throwing away the best part. You're only getting 3 grams of protein with the white, and then you get another 3 with the yolk, plus choline, inositol, methionine, lecithin are all in the yolk, which is what your body needs for cholesterol, for brain health, the whole nine.
Okay, Jenny, maybe I'll have one yolk.
Okay, it's different. So this week, he had one egg white. Then, Tuesday, he had 2 eggs scrambled. I was like, okay, we're making progress. So every day, he's been having eggs. And for dinner, he's been having tuna. And lo and behold, look who's feeling better.
He's like, okay, Jenny, I won't have any more muffins, but I'm going to drink my milk still.
And I was like, milk? For what, bro? It's like, you're not a baby. You're 78 years old, man. You don't need milk.
Oh, somebody, oh, he needs some milk.
Don't need milk. I said, what is it about milk that you need? Because you can have almond milk. They make like 1,000 cool milks now. They make rice milk, soy milk, coconut milk, almond milk, hemp milk. They got all these cool milks that you can have that you don't need regular ass milk for. He's like, no. It's because it helps my stomach. And I was like, oh, God. I was like, all right, well, this is what we can do. We can get you something else for your stomach, like some fucking Pepto-Bismol, and then you're going to stop drinking fucking milk. I said, it's not good for you. I said, it actually weakens your bones. And he's like, what? I said, yeah, because you're getting a bunch of calcium. You don't absorb it. And you get brittle bones from drinking a bunch of milk. And when I say a bunch of milk, I'm not talking like he's having a glass a day. Like he was drinking a gallon of milk a day. And I said, how much water are you drinking? He's like, oh, you know, the water I drink when I mix up the milk. And I was like, what? Holy shit. You what?
Oh, somebody, oh, he needs some milk.
little bit of water in the milk. He's like, yeah, the milk is very sweet. I like some water in it. I was like, oh my God. I said, no, man, you need to drink half your body weight a day in ounces for water, for hydration, bro. He's like, oh no, Jenny, I'll be getting up and going to the restroom too much. I said, no, that's good for you. You need to clean out all the fucking muffins you've been eating. Oh shit. I officially have a child. And then when I asked my mom, I was like, look, lady, you got to step the fuck up. You got to do something. You're the one who's cooking here. He can't cook. So you got to just make this shit for him and tell him, here, eat this. She goes, no, I'm not doing that. I don't want him to waste food. If I make it and he doesn't want it, I just have to throw it away. And I was like, I said, lady, listen, you're in fucking charge of his food. You need to be like, look, these are your options. Chicken, turkey, fish, tuna, veggies, repeat. Come on. You gotta put your foot down and start cooking right for this guy because he's in trouble. I need your help. I need you to step up. And normally I don't talk like this to my mom, but I was like, okay, look, lady, like, stop deflecting responsibility. You're the one who cooks for him. So you give him options. You don't ask him what he wants to eat. You say, what one of these three do you want to eat? Because you're going to fucking eat something. And if you're not hungry now, when you are hungry later, these are the three things or these are the options you have. So I'm going to need you to step the fuck up because I ain't doing it because I'm a terrible cook. And if I cook for my dad, he's never going to want to eat food again. I'll eat it because I don't care what it tastes like. I'm just hungry. Oh my God. So that's been my nightmare with Mifaja and my mother. Yeah, so suicide. One is fine, but Bran is quicker. Suicide with muffins is my dad with the fucking suicide solution, Bran muffins. He was eating. See, I would buy him four, and they would be gone in a day. My mom would buy him six, and they would be gone in 2 days. It was just fucking. We were on the road to diabetes. Oh, fuck. Lesson learned, kids. If your stomach is hurting and you can only have something soft, why don't you start with some fucking soup first? Some chicken noodle soup or some veggie soup. Like, we can do this with vegan options, too. Like, you don't have to just fucking eat muffins for the rest of your life and fucking have a slow death. Eat some fucking soup. Start with something bland. Eat an apple. I don't give a shit. But stay nutritious. None of this, I'm going to make up my own special diet shit, because that never works out, clearly. And we're still picking up my dad's nails. All right. I must end the show with something good, something positive. And I will do that. And this one was interesting. This was normally Jimmy. I listened to the Jimmy Dore show, and normally he's a very political show. He's not. He is mostly left. But really what I like about Jimmy Dore is that he tells you that both sides are pieces of shit. And this is why I like that. Just go on ahead and tell me how bad the left is and how bad the right is. And we should try and do something to get both of them out. I like Jimmy Dore for that. So check him out if you like politics with a perspective of everybody's full of shit. I love that he points that out. So this week he actually kind of diverted from politics. He talked a little bit about it briefly, but the biggest thing was he talked about shadow work. And shadow is not the shadow necessarily behind you, but it's the shadow within you that your shadow is some of the things that you may hide from yourself, whether it's on a surface level or it's more deep due to either past experiences or trauma. So he talks about addressing shadow work and how important it is to do that, because if you don't address your shadow work, then it comes to the light eventually, no matter what it is you do, how hard you try to contain it. If you don't do the work, try to address your shadow, it comes to the surface. So I'm gonna leave you with Jimmy Dore. Please like, share, and subscribe to Rambo Paradio, RamboParadio.com. Tell a friend, but only if they're cool, true sayers and lie slayers. This week, I hope that you guys can spend some time working on your shadow work, or at least learning what your shadow is. And the biggest thing is, don't be so hard on yourself. And remember, You can never be truly happy, but you can be content. And I can tell you, each week that I do this show, I am content as a motherfucker. And I hope you listening are too as well. But until next time, this is Rambo Radio. I'm out.
But even then, it seemed a little weird to be saying that, you know? And I go, why do you care? Why would you let them bother you? Why does that bother you that there's gay guys here? I don't understand how that would, you would let that make you leave faster, even if you're enjoying your coffee. And he just said, hey, I don't care what people do. I don't care what they do. They can do whatever they want. He goes, but I don't like being around them. It makes me nervous. They make me uncomfortable. And I was like, what? That sounded really Neanderthal to me, right? You don't like being around gay people because they make you uncomfortable. What? Later on in the week, we were drinking. We got a little drunk. And that same person admitted to me that they had, when they were little, they would watch wrestling and get an erection. So that was that person having a same-sex attraction manifesting in an erection, and then him realizing this is shameful, that I don't want to have a same-sex homosexual attraction. That's bad. This part of me is bad, and so I have to deny that it's in me. And so you put it that becomes your shadow. So if you're a heterosexual in the world, but you're your shadow side. You have this part of you that is your shadow. You stuffed into your shame bag, as Robert Bly would say. Robert Bly, the poet, he said, most people spend the first 20 years of their life putting all the parts of themselves that they hate into a shame bag, and then they spend the rest of their life trying to get those parts of themselves back out. And we shame things that we consider that might be bad, even though they're not bad, like same-sex attraction. Like, that's not inherently a bad thing. But since our society shames it, that person, that guy didn't want to identify with having same-sex attraction because then he might be a fucking weirdo. So he denies that part of himself, and that goes in his shame bag, and that's called his shadow. And so then when he gets around other gay people, when he gets around gay people, outwardly gay, it causes him anxiety inside of himself, and he doesn't quite know why. He didn't know why. He just felt uncomfortable. Why? Because that excites that part of him that he's been suppressing, that you also have same-sex attraction. It reminds him of that unconsciously. It fucking drives him crazy. And so now he's having a reaction. I got that. I'm anxious. And he doesn't know why. And so I bet every time he was around gay people, he would get anxious and edgy and maybe even angry and not know why. And that's his unconscious controlling. And so every time this happens, he's like, I end up with fucking gay guys around me. So that's his unconscious directing his life, and he's calling it fate. If I would have stuffed that down, that same-sex attraction that I felt for Jude Law watching The Talented Mr. Ripley, if I would have stuffed that down inside me, now that would have control. I would have directed my life. I would be homophobic, which is what that makes you. So now the thing that's in you makes you uncomfortable, gives you anxiety because I'm denying it. Well, since I acknowledged it, That would be my shadow, that same-sex attraction. I have this part of me that normally is shamed, I'm supposed to be ashamed of and put in my shame bag, but I didn't. I didn't put it in my shame bag. I wasn't that ashamed of it. I owned it. And I think it was because I was a comedian. I knew intrinsically I could make this funny on stage and that this would be helpful for me. So I just owned it. And that's what they talk about, integrating your shadow. So whatever is the bad part of yourself, you have to acknowledge it, that you want to murder someone, that you want to rape someone, that you want to be selfish, that you want to be greedy, that you want to be lazy, all these shadow sides of yourself that you deny. If you can acknowledge that you have them and you can actually acknowledge them, not just in some kind of intellectual exercise, but actually acknowledge these are parts of yourself. These are urges you actually have. And then you can own them. Like, a lot of people have sexual fantasies that they're ashamed of. They won't even tell their husband or wife or partner or anything. They won't tell even their psychiatrists for a long time. That's part of us, though. Where does it come from? So it's not bad or good, no matter what the sexual thing is. No matter what it is, it's just a thing. It's just a part of you. It's not good. It's not bad. It's a sexual fantasy. So that's a lot of people have that kind of shame around sex, and they push it down, and then it comes out in weird ways. So that's like how women have rape fantasies, right? So the easiest way to explain that is, let's say you grew up a Mormon and you're not allowed to have sex until you're married, or else you're a bad person. And so then, and especially a woman, right? You're a bad person. You can't enjoy sex. Then you're a slut. That's also bad. And if you have sex before you're married, then God hates you and you're bad and slutty and all that stuff. So what do you do if you're horny and you're a girl and you're Mormon? You fantasize about someone raping you. Oh, I wish someone would come along and just take me and have sex with me so that I wouldn't feel guilty about it and I wouldn't have to take responsibility for it and I could still enjoy the sexual pleasure. That's what the shadow. So if I didn't accept that shadow part of me, that part that normally males, blue collar males in America would stuff down shame, same sex attraction, I didn't. I owned it. And by doing that, it gave me like such a more solid footing sexually in my life that I wasn't denying that. It just made me feel more balanced. And that's what they say about you integrate your shadow, not that you act it out, but you acknowledge that it's in you. And then you integrate it into your personality. And there's a saying that I don't want to be a good, I'd rather be a whole person than a good person, because good people are pushing down parts of themselves. And I'd rather be, and they're not, and they're fragmented. That's called a fragmented personality. So you're literally hiding parts of yourself to your conscious self. It's still in your unconscious. And remember, our conscious mind is just the tip of the iceberg. Most of the shit that's happening is unconscious. It's underneath the water level, right? So we all know that. And then that leads into projection. And, you know, the silent sinners scream the loudest. That's all have to do with your shadow side. The parts of us that we deny. That's how people become hypocrites. And by the way, we're all hypocrites, because we all have a shadow side. So that's why hypocrisy is so easy to find, because it's fucking everywhere, because it's part of the human condition. And according to Jung and the people who've come after him, that if, you know, you can deny that we have archetypes, right? So there's a collective unconscious. I know, not to get too deep into it, but
it's interesting.
All we are is the manifestation of consciousness. So, and because we've developed an ego, not meaning like an inflated ego, I mean the scientific term ego, which makes us see ourselves as separate. So when you see a plant coming out from the earth, you know that plant is connected to the earth because it literally came out of the earth. But because we're walking around and we're not connected literally into the earth, our feet, we can pick them up. We don't see that. We literally came out of the fucking earth. We literally came out of the earth. We weren't dropped here. A Martian didn't shit an egg out and we popped out. That's not how it happened. We literally came up out of the earth just like a flower, just like a blade of grass. And the grass doesn't have an ego. The blade of grass doesn't go, I hope I'm tallest. I hope I'm the greenest blade of grass. I hope I look. So the grass doesn't see itself as separate. It just does what it does. It just does what it does. And so if I wouldn't have accepted my shadow side, my same-sex attraction to Jude Law, I would have been fighting it my whole life, and it would have been controlling me, and I would be uncomfortable and have anxiety and maybe even be violent. It would be controlling me. It's like that Bob Goldthwait joke, and I can't remember how it goes, but at the end of it, it's about guys who go out and gay bash. And he gets to the end, and he's punching a guy, and he reveals that he's really trying to beat the gay that's inside of him. That's the shadow. And then you project it. That's the shadow, and that's how it can fuck you up. And we all have it. We all have these four archetypes also that live in us unconsciously, because there is a thing called collective unconscious. We did come out of the earth. There is no separation, and we all are just physical manifestations of consciousness. That's all we are. I could talk about this for hours and hours. Separateness is an illusion. We are not separate. Just like the hairs on our head are not separate from our body, human beings are like different hairs on the earth, and we think we're separate. We're not. We all come from the same energy, and we develop this ego, meaning this, which is, again, not what you think, but it's what makes us think we're separate. And that's why we have to have a shadow. It's the shadow side of our ego, the persona that we create. The ego, the persona, has a opposite. Your personality type, you know, if you're like a, like for instance, the most easiest one to, a people pleasers, right? How do you become a people pleaser? Well, it's from the shadow. So when you're young, you literally don't know that there's a separation between you and your mother. You're just one, right? Until about the age of two. And then because you're constantly looking towards your mother, a baby recognizes her mother's face or mother's voice and totally needs the attention from the mother or the primary caregiver. And so what happens is when you start to, you want to please your primary caregiver because you want the attention that your primary caregiver gives you, your mother. Let's just say your mother. It's hardwired into you to need a connection with your mother because you need that stability, safety, and you also then need approval. And so you're hardwired to seek approval from your primary caregiver, your mother. So when you do something that your mother approves of and smiles, you do more of it because your mother's happiness makes you happy. Your mother is giving you attention, and if you've learned you make her happy, you're going to get that back. And when that gets out of whack, you become a people pleaser and a doormat. And then you start to, when your mother doesn't allow you to be yourself and makes you start squelching your own wants, desires, and needs, and just who you are as a person. And you have to start squelching parts of who you are to keep your mother happy. Because the most important thing in you and your world is your connection to your mother and your security and safety. And if your mother shows you disapproval constantly, you're going to keep figuring out ways to get it. And so that's how you become a pleaser and you deny your own wants. And that actually feels good. That actually makes people pleasers happy when someone else is happy and denying their own wants and desires. Now, that's destructive. That if you do that all the time, you become a doormat and that's self-destructive and you never get to live the life that you want to live. You're always doing what someone else wants to. But it is helpful in certain situations to be like that because we all have it in us. What do you mean? Well, when you have a guest over for dinner, right? Now, I've been having people over for dinner now for a long time in my life, right? I love having people over for dinner. Why? Because I like cooking and serving them and seeing the happiness on their face. People I like, people that I love who are in my life, my close friends and family, I like pleasing them. It makes me happy. It's the same kind of brain pattern of when you're a baby with your mother. I like pleasing people. But to a big degree. So when someone comes over to my house, I'll be like, can I get you anything? Can I do something for you? Can I get you a drink? Do you want some food? How about my favorite chair? Because right now my comfort is secondary because your comfort is primary. I'm like your servant and your happiness makes me happier than my physical comfort. I'm willing to endure physical discomfort if it makes you happy. That's the psychological process. So that, and so even to the point where I've had people at my house and they'll go, oh, it's too hot in here. And so I'll turn down the heat. I'll be a little colder myself. So they'll be happy. So I'll put myself through physical pain for someone else's physical pleasure if I know it makes them happy because their happiness actually makes me happier than my own physical pleasure. That's the same psychology in a BDSM sex with submissives. They just sexualize that. They sexualize that. They sublimate their own wants and desires for someone else's wants and desires. And if they're happy, then they're happy. But you have to keep it. If you can do it in those situations, then it's healthy, right? Because you're discovering those other parts of your psyche, and that brings you balance. Most of the time, I'm a go-getter guy. I'm an achiever. I got to get this. I need this. Give me this. I'm demanding this. But when someone comes over to my house as a guest, I then become the opposite. I become the people pleaser. Whatever you want makes me happy, whatever you want. And I only do that in certain situations, like when I have company. If I did that 24 hours a day, I'd become a doormat. So the ability to do that when I want to and then draw a hard boundary after. That's how, when you're healthy and you have healthy individuation, meaning you can be yourself, and now I can decide not to please you, right? I'm making that decision. So when you come to my house as a guest for dinner, I make the conscious decision, I'm going to please you. And me pleasing you will give me more happiness than me actually trying to please myself. Do you follow? And so we all do with aversion. But if so, and then that's healthy, because now I'm activating the other part of my psyche that I don't put forward most of the time. So most of the time, I'm this fucking aggressive guy who gets shit done and is making things happen. I need this. I need that. I'm going to do that. But there's also another part of my psyche that needs to please and serve that I don't normally put forward in my everyday life. So I'll take time out, and when I have guests, I'll do that. And that brings me balance. Okay, so that as and that brings, so that's how you can have balance. And I can control when I'm being a people pleaser. I can control when I'm being a servant to someone for my own pleasure. I'm being a servant for my own pleasure, turns out. Someone else's pleasure, happiness, is actually my pleasure. In what, because I've decided it in this certain situation, which we all do that. We all do that. And so that's the psychology also, again, I said, behind submissive sexuality. They can turn off their brain, stop thinking, your happiness is my happiness, and I can contain it in this little box. I don't do that in the rest of my life. I don't run around. I don't go to a restaurant. Can I get you something? Can I help it? No, I let someone else serve me. So my unconscious isn't driving me to be a people pleaser in all other situations. I can acknowledge when I like to be a people pleaser, which is the shadow to my aggressive ego side that I put towards to the world most of the time. I can acknowledge I have this people pleaser part of me, this urge to please people, and I can then play with it. I can then explore it, and that gives me balance. The shadow work is the one you probably know the least about because it's the one people don't want to do the most. You mean I'm going to go to pay you so I could find out the fucking shittiest parts of myself actually exist? The thing that I hate the most in other people is actually in me. I don't want to pay you for that. So this is the work most people don't do. Nobody wants to find out that they actually can be a Nazi. And then, of course, people who are fully awake, like people like Eckhart Tolle, you know, enlightened people, people who are enlightened, they don't have to worry about any of this stuff because they completely transcend the ego and the shadow. They see their physical form as not being who they truly are because it isn't who we truly are. We're temporarily taking on a physical form. We're actually just the consciousness energy. And we come into being and we go back out of being. There is no death. There is no death. We're just pure energy. We are just energy condensed to a slow vibration. That's all we are. And as you know from physics, energy cannot be created nor destroyed. It can only change form. So the energy that's in me has always been here since the fucking Big Bang. The energy that's moving my mouth and my fingers right now has always been here, has always been here. So it means I've always been here. Energy cannot be created nor destroyed. It can only change forms. Death is not the opposite of life. Death is the opposite of birth. There is no opposite to life. Life is forever, eternal, everlasting. There is no opposite to life. When you die, you don't die. This physical form dies, but that's not who you are. And enlightened people know that, so they don't get caught up in the ego or the shadow. They've transcended it. They've transcended their ego. And that's what happens when people take mushrooms or acid or DMT. They transcend their ego, and they see that they're not who they thought they were at all, and that there is no separation. That's where we are. And then you have to say, oh, really? There is a world. So then why do I have to worry about anything? Well, you have to be in the world, but not of it. And that means you have to have one foot in the spiritual world where your true essence is and one foot in the physical world. And it's the perfect balance. You have to, while you're here, have compassion for human beings taking on physical form. But know that it's a perfectly So there's suffering in the world, and you should try to alleviate suffering when you can. You should be compassionate.
I'm just Hispanic. Wow. Wow. Pleasure.
Wow. Wow. Wow.
Wow.
Wow.
Wow. Wow. Wow. Wow. Wow.